Ladies and gentlemen, Pranav Mistry, a renowned scientist and inventor. His contribution? Yeah, go ahead, Pranav Mistry. His contribution to the fields such as wearable computing, augmented reality, and gestural computing puts him in the elite list of pioneers and inventors that shape the future of digital world. He was awarded the 2009 Inventor of the Year Award by Popular Science. The World Economic Forum has honored Mistry as one of the young global leaders in 2013. At the moment, he serves as the head of the think tank and global vice president of research at Samsung. In this role, he is the leading research and development He heads the research and development of Samsung's future. Mistry is best known for his inventions of the sixth sense and the Samsung Gear. So without absolutely any delay, please put your hands together yet again and let's invite center stage, Mr. Mistry. Welcome.
Thank you. It is wonderful to be part of this event, and let me just begin. It is my first time to be in Kochi, and I've never experienced the beauty, beautiful sea of this side of the nation. And as another say, the food, I'm enjoying the food. Let me just get my clicker, and then we can begin. So my name is Pranav Mistry, and at my current role at Samsung, I get to design and develop and create and invent what is next. Today, my topic that I want to discuss today with you, all of you, is about future of mobile and wearables. But I took a liberty in changing the topic to future of information technology altogether. Because mobile phone today is have taken the center stage of everything we do. I want to start with one simple trivia question to all of you. When was the first tablet launch? A, B, C? Anyone else? If you ask me to put another option, I would put 5500 BCE. The reason was because a clay tablet in Babylon that we found is also a tablet. This was an information device. Of course, it was not interactive and we are not playing games on the top of that thing. But in 1700 BCE, we found a tablet which was even talking about PTO requests from the employees on an organization. If you go several miles from here in Ajanta Caves, you will see paintings which is showing the information in a different medium. I would say this is an information technology at that time. terracotta warriors in China, you will see those statues are telling us how they used to dress, how they used to use weapons. What is information technology? It's about telling us information. What was happening throughout all this innovation is that information is just changing a different technology one to another. We have scriptures, now we started learning language. People started writing on bamboos with those characters. So what is happening in this history with this new guy came into place in 1400, Gutenberg. He invented the printing press. And now we started sharing things with our friends, the books. Not the one copy of the book that we are used to write one by one, now we have multiple copies of that. That's the first Bible. And that's the make the spread of the whole religion possible. Now the information started changing only from visual to sound. Radio was invented. So now we are getting one-way information just for the sound. With the invention of the camera, now we are able to capture those information into visual form. TV came. Moving pictures, moving images. So if you are looking at what is happening is that in this all this history, the information technology for thousands of years is same. Our urge for the information is same. It's just the technology, the piece, the medium is changing. With the ones and zero, now we into computer age, where the information not only was one way, because until now the radios and TVs was only one way. I was just getting, I was a consumer, I'm just listening, I'm just watching. But now I can interact with that information. And today, our laptops and the phones that fit in our pockets is the as same information providing devices that used to be in terracotta warrior times or even in the Buddhist scripture time. So if you notice, the key part, of course, the digital revolution of the information is not ending there. This was us. Day before yesterday, we announced the latest version of the Galaxy device. And I cannot be more proud of being part of this team in bringing those new and new technology that makes our access to the information much more seamless, much more fun, much more interactive, and that drives the whole of the world. I would also say that we are still pushing the boundary. Every year, we are pushing the boundaries of this technology can do. Another example of what we were able to announced day before yesterday in San Francisco. Let me just show you that.
Come with me and you'll be in a world of your imagination. Take a look and you'll see into your imagination. We'll begin with a spin through. What we'll see will defy explanation. If you want to view paradise, now simply look around and view it. And anything you want to do it. Wanna change the world? There's nothing to
So that's tomorrow. Or even I would say it's today now, because all of you can actually have this in your pocket, right? But the difference between that 5,500-year-old tablet and this tablet, from the consumer perspective, from the user perspective, the aim for information is not changing. So this particular question that what is next, I'm not talking about what is next device that we are going to announce or launch or what the next phone you're going to have or buy. But the meta level question that what is that next information medium altogether is. That's what keeps driving me for almost last 20 years. And when I say information technology, the information part is the only thing which is staying stable. The medium is keep changing. So that's why I personally believe and that we are on the verge then when the information is going to change its home again. The change that we have seen from radios to TVs and TVs to computers, computers to phone, we believe that now this is an exciting time, that now we are going to have some different kind of future where our urge of information will stay same, but things will change. I started this journey not long before, almost 35 years before, from Palanpur, a small town north of Gujarat. So you can see where it's Kochi right now, but I come from this area of India. And throughout my career, early school educations, I got education in architecture, design, engineering, like doing those electrical engineering stuff to software engineering. I get a chance to work with the brightest mind in NASA, Google, UNESCO, and also many places in the world, with the one single aim that what is that next information medium will be. So, and many of you are aware of many of my past work, so I don't want to go into details of that, but you can see the glimpses of that, that this was 20 years before when I was making virtual world interaction using my hand, or making glasses that can see different languages for different people in the real world. So an advertisement can be seen for different people in a different language. Or even was doing the augmented reality version of the pot making, you know, the pottery that we do in real world. The sixth sense device came and it changed people's perception about the information because now we can have the dynamic world into the real world. So we did many of these things. Don't drink more coffee, this is your third coffee already. We can do all this kind of augmented reality thing on the real world, right? I will not go into details of this today because that's the topic of the another day. Or you're already aware of this one. At that time, I was also exploring the form factors of the glasses because I didn't believe that the information only need to stay in phones or tablets or a place. It can be anywhere. So you can see my wife that time. So she was my first user to test it out. She's reading a magazine, a fashion magazine, and she was able to buy right there, even see the prices of those information and buy, click, say, okay, I want to add this to my cart. And this is the real physical paper magazine, right? All these experiments you have seen into translated to now virtual world. So when I went to Samsung, I continue this journey for making the virtual reality as you are, many of you experience this thing. And even we have seen industry also catch up to this moment. A couple of years before, Google Glass introduced the Google new way of doing and interacting in the real world. One of our partners and good friends at Microsoft, they make HoloLens. So now, actually, the augmented reality can be massive slowly. It's still not that mature that every one of us right now replace our phones with these devices, but that world is coming. I'm not sure that this is the information medium that I was in search for, but this is a good beginning. And of course, in order to have that interaction, we need now supporting things. Like those TVs require the new cameras. So this new world will require new kind of cameras, new kind of other hardware, new kind of technology to capture those information. So all of my work in current days, I'm going a step further. Even the software need to advance. So your camera, when you look out, so this is the real system working at my lab, where you can just look at the real world, and the camera can analyze what is in front of you, so you can put the information, put whatever you want to interact with, digital world, into the real world. So with our phone, today we can already do this thing. So in my days in MIT, what I was envisioning as a glasses device is, it will still take some time to be mass market, I feel, or it will, or maybe it will be something different, but our phones can now already start interacting with the real world. What does it change for this audience? So think about that. The real estate advertisement market is again going to be a big thing, because now it's no longer only about digital in the digital space. Now physical space will again become valuable from perspective of a consumer to know more things about, or where the things are, or advertisements, interact with those advertisements in real world. So, and I'm sure that many of you can already start using these devices and already using some of these applications that is happening there. So I will skip and then go to the next one. Of course, the wearable version of this might give you a little bit more hands-free experience of that thing. So now, this is a real environment. Now you can go with your this wearable device and start interacting with this thing. This kind of world looks very nice. Of course, currently it's a good way to say portraying is nice. But there can be a dark side of this thing. And let me explain you what is the dark side of that thing. So this is an ideal scenario where everything works, everything is nice. But in real world,
estoy libre de mí.
You might end up in this situation.
Adiós.
I'm not sure how many of you want to live in this future. That's an arguable question. But now what is happening is that all the things that is happening in our phone, keeping us occupied when we go to a Google search and we are seeing advertisement for free and this thing, is going to be in the real world all the time. So a person is going shopping right now. In this particular case, the person is actually wearing a glasses kind of device, and then now she is able to see the world in this particular manner. And imagine this is the de facto after 2 years. And I think that's what sometimes you want. You want to turn off those things. We want to turn off our phones sometime or turn off our computer and go back to the real world. So I didn't want to portray only the negative side of the world, because that is the responsibility of people like me and, of course, people like you, both sides, because the content side as well as the creator side, we need to ensure that ethically we are making the right decision, bringing the right information medium into place for future to come. And how we do that? So, if you ask me, I personally look into this one a little bit more scientifically, because I come from that background. So, forgive me if I'm going a little bit more physics than something, but bear with me. I will stop in that case. But if you look at the real world into time, space, or matter domain, just for a while, just for a second, imagine the reverse axis also exists, like time, so no time, space, no space. Matter, no matter. What you are doing in this way, that actually you are placing the atoms and bits in places. So matter becomes the bits in this case, or the space become from real space to virtual space, right? So now we have this whole real world portrayed into an imaginary axis scenarios. If I now start putting what is reality, what is virtual reality, what is augmented reality, you can easily see that a different part of this one. So you can see where is reality, which is the real space, real time, real matter. There's virtual reality, as we know, means VR glasses that we have used. That fits the completely opposite side of that. Augmented reality fits where you're mixing the real with the physical. This is the kind of the reference guidebook people like me use in order to invent new stuff, that where we are heading in order to bring the next information medium or next technology altogether. In order to simplify this one, I'm just putting this into that form, the eight areas that you can see that. There can be more. I might be missing an axis altogether. But what is happening over here that you're imagining a new way of looking into the problem that we are trying to solve, the information medium. Another way of looking this one is a more philosophical way. And I'm really a big fan of some of these Chinese poems because my other family is coming from China, where I learned Chinese language and I found this interesting poem. The poem is about dream, a dream of a butterfly. The title of the poem says, "The Dream of a Butterfly." Let me read it out very quickly to you guys. It says that once upon a time, I dreamed I was a butterfly flying higher and higher to all my intents and purposes of a butterfly. I was conscious only of my happiness as a butterfly, unaware that I was a Chow, the writer of the poem himself. Soon I wake up, and there I was, myself again. Now I do not know whether I was then a man dreaming I was a butterfly or whether I'm now a butterfly dreaming I'm a man. So this loop of thinking about reality, augmented reality, virtuality, or even the other reality, it excites us as a researcher, as a philosophers, as a designers, and as a human being, and that's what keep us driving for what is next in this case. I mean, you can have this. You can have a virtual reality world. Inside, you can have a virtual reality world. So you might be using your VR and there where you are doing shopping, and then you buy another VR glasses and you go into that second dream of the virtual reality. Possible. Those days are not far from now. And our perception of reality, perception of information technology, perception of how we get information itself going to change. So I don't want to go too much technical on philosophy and those particular part. But another thing, that future of information technology, as I was saying, is more about future of how we may interact. How we may interact with the information, or how we may interact with each other itself. Because right now, our phone is not only a device for us to get information. A phone is the communication device for me to the world, to my friends, to my families, to you, to everyone. And that magic of technology is going to change, as I mentioned before, that medium is going to change very soon. It's an exciting time. So what I want to, of course, after my talk, and I'm going to converse with you, a lot of you discussion. In fact, I want to learn also your thoughts about how consumers' behavior about thinking in the real world about technologies are changing. What I'm giving a glimpse that how we can design or be ready for the world of information that is going to come. So next year, I might not be showing you the foldable new phone or new augmented reality glasses, but I might be giving you another hint of a new information medium or another step that we go work further in that. Or I can give you a glimpse of what I can bring you next year.
When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what will I be?
Will I be pretty?
Will
I be rich?
Here's
what she said to me.
It's a lot, it's a lot. Whatever will be, the future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. What will be, will be.
Que sera.
Thank you.
So one beat at a time, one step a day, we are trying to bring the future near. And in this role, we all need to work together. Society, the people, the designers, the engineers. So there is two ways to look into this future. What one Lincoln said, that the best thing about the future is that it comes one day at a time. It takes time. Or another way is my favorite way, that what Einstein said, that I never think of the future because it comes soon enough. So I feel that we need to take an active step, both ethically and non-ethically, technologically, non-technologically, to make this future the future that we want to live in. With that thought, I would say thank you.
Thank you so much. Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the joy of inviting on stage Mr. Joy Alukas, Chairman and Managing Director, Joy Alukas Group, to please present a token of appreciation to the very talented Mr. Mistry. A very warm welcome to you, sir. Thank you very much for helping us with the honors. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Joy Alukas. Mr. Alukas is known as the man with the Midas touch. He started with a single jewelry showroom in the year 87. And today, brand Joy Alukas has about 160 and more showroom retail chains with a presence in 11 countries around the world. A brand that has won many awards and accolades. And the man himself has featured in the Forbes Middle East Power List. His immense success has not affected his humility, as you can see. Thank you, sir, for helping us out. He still wears his heart on his sleeve and undertakes as many CSR programs as possible to help those in need in our society. The latest being taking up the task of building 250 homes for the people of Kerala who have been severely impacted by the devastating floods last year. Thank you, sir. You are a man with a golden heart. Ladies and gentlemen, there you go. A global businessman, but a true Keralite at heart. So, come on, Kerala.